things in here. Don't take any of this too seriously. I wanted to give you a little confidence in me. I wanted to show you this was a stock picking contest where I went against one of the top financial minds in this country, Mike Ditka, and was able to beat the coach. In fact, I was the investment instructor for the Saints players for a number of years, and that was a real trip because these guys, they're just like you and me. They're nothing like you and me, really. They're gigantic and young and very wealthy. And now the Saints are world champions, so I can't use the joke I used to use, which was, you know, why don't the Saints have a website? And that's because they've never been able to put together three W's, you know, which is no longer can do that. We're really good. I know that MDRT is out of Chicago, so I thought I'd replace it with a different line. And I said, what did Jesus say to the Cubs? Listen, don't do anything till I get back. So it's a, so they wanted to get the Chicago people out there. I'm a big athlete. I don't wear a cup. I wear a quart. It's kind of an interesting thing. Let's see. Here's the facts. We're not entering another Great Depression. I know this is going to be a real bummer for the media, but this is not where we're headed. If you look at the crash of 29 and the depression that occurred afterwards, the government is embarking on a program that is completely the opposite of what the government did back there. In the 30s, the government increased interest rates, they increased tariffs, and they slowed government spending to a trickle. We are going the other way. We have interest rates basically at zero, unprecedented amounts of government spending. If you look at it, and this is really the best way to look at this situation, is I like to look at Ben Bernanke. Ben Bernanke, some people like him, some people don't like him, but he is the nation's preeminent scholar on the Great Depression. He is sort of born for the position he's in right now, and that's one reason I'm a little more optimistic than a lot of people. A typical recession averages 14 months in length. If you listen to the media, you would think it'd be about 14 years. You know, I'm watching Wolf Blitzer on The Situation Room talking about the economy, and even I'm getting scared now, you know, And I think to myself, damn, if my name was Wolf, I would not grow a beard. That would be the first thing I wouldn't do. But before this, we've had two recessions in the last 30 years, the early 90s, and then that dot-com meltdown in 2000, 2001. You remember, that's when everybody wanted to own stocks, particularly these dot-com internet companies. Remember, these were companies with no earnings, no cash flow, no assets. Who knew? I don't know why that didn't turn out better. I remember in 1999, I teach old-fashioned Ben Graham, Warren Buffett financial analysis, and the dot-coms were kind of an anathema to me. And I had a student came up to me in 99. He said, Mr. Ri-Shooty, I like found a stock I think is going to do like really well because like my friend Josh told me about it. And I'm looking at like we're doing in class, and I notice it doesn't have a P.E. I said, oh, there's a reason for that, Jimmy. It has no E. You know, it's kind of a... I was an old Italian, angry Italian man on campus. You know, as people always say something in Italian. The body's in the trunk. You know, And of course, a recession is all in the way you spin it, right? If you're a banker and you go to somebody's house and knock on the door, and you say, hey, I'm here to foreclose. Well, those people are pretty angry. But if you go to the same house, knock on the door, say, hey, you're going camping. Yeah, I think that's a lot nicer. I think that's it's a nicer spin, really. I have a friend that lost his job. He always corrects me whenever I say that, though. He always says, I didn't lose my job. I know where my job is. They just, you know, won't let me back in the building. So it's a different angle. But remember, recessions always end and the economy always rises to a higher plateau. And that has been true since the earth cooled. But people don't want to remember it. In the last few years, I keep hearing the four most dangerous words in finance. This time it's different. And it's never different. It is a cycle. I've been doing this for 32 years. I've been with the investment firm at Kidder Peabody. I managed all the money for the state. This is what we need to see, is it is just a cycle. This time it's different is always wrong. That's the four most dangerous words in finance. The seven most dangerous words overall are, hey, we're getting the band back together. That's usually another problem. But it's... But let's see what the... And I don't like the way we get financial analysis either, right? I mean, you know, instead of looking at really what the facts are, which is what I'm going to lay out in here, instead we usually send a reporter to a Walmart somewhere and ask him, you scared of losing your job? You think the economy's bad? It's like, that's right. I'm scared. Real scared. It's like, back to you, Bob. People are scared. You know, this is ludicrous what we're doing. This is crazy. And whenever Walmart you go in the world, it's always the same thing. You walk in the door, is that old guy with the blue vest, the greeter guy, you know, and he always like, so how you doing? I always want to say, isn't it obvious? I'm at Walmart. You know, Jesus. things are good, I'd be at Nordstrom's or Macy's. You know, it's, Now, we're all disappointed with the Congress over the last 6 or 8 weeks. I mean, it's deplorable. But that resulted in a credit downgrade, falling stock prices, and lots of investor fear. There's a ton of fear out there right now. However, the economy seems to be self-medicating. In other words, we're seeing energy prices are down. That's going to help consumer confidence, taking less money away at the pump. Mortgage rates are down to new lows, and the U.S. dollar is down. And we're going to talk a little bit about why that's beneficial to export and budget issues. And so if we go forward, I got this out of the Onion, White House jester beheaded for making fun of soaring national debt. And I wanted to talk about the debt because I think there's a lot of misunderstanding about the debt. First of all, what you need to look at is if you look way to the left-hand side, what counts is not the absolute number of the debt, $14,674 trillion. I don't know what it is. It is national debt divided by the size of the economy. That is how you get a perspective of how big the debt is. That's the only way to look at it. And if you look at it going back since the 1940, you can see we've been higher than this before. That percentage has been worse. During World War II, it peaked. That made sense because we were borrowing a lot of money to fund the war. And then, of course, we were producing a lot for the military, so it wasn't a lot of private manufacturing into GDP. So what you had there is it was very, very high. And then after the war, it came down under Truman, down under Eisenhower, down under Kennedy, LBJ, down under Nixon, Ford. It sort of bottomed in the Carter administration. That's why I get a big kick out of the people who say, what we need for the economy is to pay off all the debt. The time we had the lowest debt was really a pretty crummy economy. Then it went up under Bush, Reagan, went back down under President Clinton. There's a lot of misunderstanding there. A lot of people say when President Clinton left office, we had a surplus. Well, we did. We had a budget surplus. We brought in more money than we had anticipated. But that does not mean we didn't have debt. We had a ton of debt. And you can see it right on the graph. And then, of course, it soared under President Bush and President Obama. Now that's the case of where we are. I'm going to say we don't have to pay off the debt. Some debt is actually good. We have too much debt right now. But you need some leverage. The best operating structure for a corporation is not all cash. The best operating structure for a family isn't necessarily no debt. You need some structure in there. We just need to get that line starting to go down the other side. And I think it's in the cards a lot faster than people believe it will be. First of all, we're going to probably pay some higher taxes. I don't know. I'm not a policy wonk. Some people are saying it's going to be taxes over on income more than $250,000. Other people are saying it'll be taxes on income more than $500,000. The new proposal is that they would tax income made by somebody over $1 million a year. I don't know what it is. And I do know this, really. The bottom line is that if your family uses the term summer as a verb, you're probably going to pay higher taxes. That's what I'm thinking. That's kind of a little general thing. I think it'll help you out here. The English majors, I got it. I told your mom it was a good major. We're going to have to see some budget cuts. We've already seen some budget cuts. There's more. I have more faith in this committee of 12 than most people. I think there'll be some solid cuts coming out of there. That's going to help. The third part of the numerator of that equation is changes to entitlement programs. Now, you say, Peter, that's ridiculous. Nothing's happened. Why do you feel optimistic about that? Well, I've been doing this for 32 years, and I've never seen anybody even bridge to touch these issues before. It's what we used to call in politics a third rail issue. If a politician even mentions something about changing entitlements, all of a sudden it's like, where's Bob? Bob's gone. You know, we're having real meetings with real TV cameras now. It's great. And something will be done. I think Social Security, we're going to have to raise that age out. We're going to have to tweak a lot of things. Maybe move Social Security out to 70 years, something like that. You're going to have to see it. You need all three of these things. And finally, the denominator is higher revenue from a rebounding economy, which is happening. I'm going to show you that we're not contracting. We're still growing, albeit not as at higher rate as people would want. This is the interest burden on the debt, by the way. Kind of surprising. We're now paying less in interest than we are since the mid-1970s. Now, the reason that is we're borrowing a lot of money, but rates are so low that we are not really being eaten up by interest costs. And that's something a lot of people misunderstand.